you're on. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Fertility Talks. I'm your host, Mary Wong. But in a minute, we're going to switch over and we're going to have a new host just to create a change. And the talk tonight is about fertility, all the good news you need to know. And we decided to change things up because, you know, the state of the world is different. So, Zuzana, I'm just going to actually like segue straight to you and you can take control of this lovely meeting.
Okay. So I'll be the moderator tonight for Fertility Talks and just a bit about myself. I'm the co-founder of BooknBrunch, and we're an online platform that allows anybody to host and attend book and food experiences. In real life, we're about creating safe space, connection, networking, and creating really meaningful conversations over a book and a meal. The original in real life event was supposed to happen today, actually at this time, 8:30 on the 1st. And as you said, things are changing, so we are pivoting. I think pivoting is the word of the week and probably the word of the month, and we're going to take it virtually, but we will be postponing the event. Right now, I was very optimistic for May 13th, but we'll see where it takes us, and we'll continue to do that with in June. Whatever we need to do, we will be putting this event on. And it's an event to give hope and positivity in your fertility journey. So I myself am a former patient of Dr. Ari Baratz, and also currently doing my 5 months pregnant and doing my fertility journey, a healthy fertility journey with Mary Wong. So I'm going to introduce our speakers today, and we're going to start with Mary Wong. So she's been in practice for 27 years. She's the founder of Alive Holistic Health Clinic, author of Pathways to Pregnancy, one of my favorite books. We'll talk about that later. Certified high-performance coach and fertility strategist, creator and host of Fertility Talks, international speaker, acupuncturist, and former IV patient who struggled with infertility. She sits on the board, Ontario government appointed expert panel for infertility and adoption, and the report of this panel lay the groundwork for IVF funding in Ontario. Amazing. We're gonna now introduce Dr. Ari Baratz. He's a dedicated to women's health and reproductive medicine for over 20 years. He is one of a select few fertility physicians in Canada with accreditation and advanced level of training required for the care of people dealing with infertility and recurrent miscarriages. And he's my doctor and he's awesome. Both of you guys are awesome. So. I have to say that because it's about emotions, right? So, I came to both of you, Mary and Dr. Baratz, and I didn't have much hope, and I was really feeling despaired, and I feel like that has been given back to me with using, you know, an Eastern medicine perspective and a Western medicine perspective to give us that hope, and here I am, 5 months pregnant. So we want to continue this talk and go forward with a positivity and what, as Mary was saying, you know, the good news that's happening right now in the corona situation and what we can do. So we're here to discuss about the good news while trying to conceive in this time. So learning about the pivots, we talk about pivots a lot during this time and what's available, again, from an Eastern perspective, medicine, and a Western perspective. So we're going to hand it over soon to Mary, but the good news is we have telemedicine. So Mary, can you please elaborate on what is currently available from an Eastern perspective with telemedicine and how you have pivoted in this time?
Yeah, it's a really great question. And, you know, initially we were scratching our heads. It's like, now what, right? Because people came for acupuncture and, you know, the full in-house experience. And that's because of the social distancing and the actual government and Ministry of Health stepping in, and my College of Acupuncturists, they said, you know, this is not an essential service, right? And when it's not deemed essential, then we had to abide by that. And in fact, we actually closed down before they made that recommendation, just to, you know, honor what is going on in the world, right? And respect nature and help the course of, hopefully will help the course, right? And how it's supposed to go and how it'll resolve. So we had to pivot. And so right now, we, like, for example, yesterday, I don't know if you were on, but we created a live event on the web. It was a webcast, and we did it for 2 hours with some of my teammates at Alive, and it was so powerful. And one of the comments was, wow, Mary, I left, like, you know, after the talk and the demonstrations and all that, I walked away feeling just as relaxed as I would after an acupuncture session. So that was so awesome and powerful. And it just gave me more of this drive to say, you know what, we can do more. And so what if it looks like I'm going to get on the phone with you and we're going to go through our full history. You're going to show me your tongue because that's part of the tongue diagnosis. I obviously cannot do a pulse diagnosis in checking your radial arteries, but I can certainly look at your tongue, ask you all the questions, ask all the questions about your menstrual cycle, because we have a different viewpoint than in Western science. And this science is only, we call it a science and art medicine in regards to Chinese medicine, and it's been around for 5,000 years. So there's something to it. Let's just say that. And so it's like, how do we bring this to you? So now we're like, okay. And there are studies, and I'll have to post that up too. There's one study that was talking about the effectiveness of acupressure. So we're bringing that in through telemedicine. So we would go through and do the intake history and check in, and we could do it weekly because the prescription of acupuncture points change depending on what cycle time you're in, you know, where you are energetically, how you're feeling emotionally, all of that. So then we would prescribe the points and customize it and show you how to do it. And so we're going to do that. And then there's still the possibility of doing herbal medicine, and that would be shipped to you directly. And then, you know, in terms of overall dietary and supplemental care, and of course, for me, myself, and I'll speak for myself because I don't know if all acupuncturists do this, but in terms of that mindset shift, which I believe is so important.
One thing I forgot to mention is I want everybody, and we're going to do Q&A at the end of this, is to write your questions or comments. We want to do about 15 to 20 minutes of Q&As, and we will get through every question and comment. So if it takes longer, so be it. That's what we're going to do. So please, below, write your comments, your questions, anything you have for Mary and Dr. Baratz, and we'll be answering them at the end. So I'm going to hand it over to Dr. Baratz, and we're going to talk about how you in telemedicine are pivoting from a Western perspective and what you guys are doing currently at Create Fertility Center.
First of all, thank you, Zuzana, for the kind introduction. It's always special to help someone, but to see someone helping others, I feel part of that. So I think that that's a great state to be in, and thank you for that. Telemedicine is interesting because even though it implies something very high tech, which it is, I mean, we're using computers and networks, and now we use Zoom platforms. We've been using telemedicine for a very long time. In fact, I've been, myself and other professionals, not just in fertility, have been using telemedicine to reach Canadians and other international people who are far away from the clinic. So it's actually a very well-established platform, very well-suited for COVID. And so it was the natural pivot to increase the amount of telemedicine that we were doing. Certainly does pose challenges. The challenges being there's a gap between, as per what Mary described, the history, which is so valuable, and in some ways very classical. We learn a lot about people by talking to them, but we don't have that opportunity to evaluate, investigate from a Western perspective, which in many situations is quite critical to providing a pathway for care. That being said, telemedicine offers that initial connection. It offers us the opportunity to identify very obvious or significant issues. And even though we can't act right now, because we don't know exactly when the COVID restrictions will end, it does set people along a pathway to either encourage them, inspire them, and we don't lose that time. And so maybe we'll talk a little bit about that later on, but in terms of a platform, telemedicine is a great opportunity across medical care, not just infertility, but if you have any other medical problems, this might be a great time to engage a referral or talk about it again with your primary care provider.
Right. So I'm going to make a comment here because when I spoke to you last, I actually had no idea that you were going to be taking new consultations. Mm-hmm. And I thought, wow, that's a great idea because this is the time.
Yeah, I mean, I feel that as we've talked about, and I think in the spirit of trying to find the positivity here, most of us are having quite a bit more downtime, time to do other projects at home, and perhaps looking at the mirror and seeing, do I really want to be pregnant in the next year? Because if the answer is yes, then I feel the consultation is quite critical. If the answer is no, then maybe a telemedicine consult might be a bit premature. But that's typically one of the questions I start asking people is, do you want to conceive in the next 6 to 12 months? If that's yes, then we do need to meet. And you might want to start by asking that to your primary care provider or your Eastern medicine provider.
Right. It's a, I feel it's a combination of both Western and Eastern medicine. So that's so during this time, Dr. Baratz, have you been doing a lot of consultations? You know, we want to give that hope that you don't have to put your anything to halt. You know, like you said, if there's a timeline that you're on, then definitely.
Right. So a few things. So first of all, I think it's important to realize that I don't want to paint a picture that's not real. I mean, this is a very frustrating and difficult time for all of us. Our lives have been affected medically, emotionally, socioeconomically. We're hurting as a society. We know that. And no one is anyway trying to say that these are good times. These are dark times for all of us. And I think it's amazing that we're able to still maintain and keep on going.
Right.
So, you know, my first choice would not to be to do telemedicine. My first choice would be to do inpatient medicine or face-to-face. But I think a primer for the group, and I'm sure many people are aware, that the American Society for Reproductive Medicine, the Canadian Society for Reproductive Medicine, as well as the European Society, has actually come down with some directives, recommendations, almost like very, very stern guidelines to suggest that really all fertility treatment should be halted right now, except for a few circumstances. The one circumstance that you're allowed to continue is ongoing cycles. So if there are any cycles that preceded the COVID self-isolation, social distance directive, those can continue and be completed, which they are being completed as we speak. And the other group are the newly diagnosed cancer patients who are going through therapies that will be toxic to their future fertility. So that group is not being restricted at all. And certainly if they are undergoing chemotherapy or radiation therapy, they should be engaging in what we call oncofertility. So fertility clinics are still open, but in a very sparing way. So telemedicine was a natural pivot because that is, as we said, something that we can do in the meanwhile. I wanted to mention that for the last couple weeks, most of the fertility world has been very frustrated because of these limitations and restrictions. But I think that it is reassuring that both the Canadian and American Society have come out with some recent clarifications, which I think is important for our audience. So the clarifications, and there's about 10 of them, but I would say three that are the most important for all of us are: number one, acknowledging and continuing to emphasize that infertility is a disease. It is not an optional state. It is something that is serious. And like many areas of medicine, we are having to triage between COVID care and other care. So in no way is anyone trying to suggest that by delaying someone's fertility surgery or delaying their IVF cycle, that it is not critical. It's just trying to say that if that care was suspended by 1 or 2 months, the overall impact would not be as great if someone was not to receive COVID care, for example. So I think that was an important clarification. The other one that I think is really important is that the task force is committed to returning to routine patient care as soon as possible. So we're all evaluating and trying our best to get back to normal as soon as we can. I think all these social distancing measures will get us there faster. And finally, a very stern clarification to reassess what we consider urgent and non-urgent infertility care. So right now, the only case that's urgent are considered the cancer cases, but perhaps people with lower egg reserve or other fertility concerns that are becoming increasingly urgent with this delay, perhaps they may be able to initiate in the coming weeks or months. I can't guarantee that, but that's something that everyone is looking at. So very often fertility patients the last couple of weeks have felt very alone, that no one really is advocating for them. But I can tell you that all of your providers, including myself, are constantly meeting and trying to see ways that we can get back to normal as soon as we can.
That's great to hear. I think that's what people are feeling, a bit isolated, lonely during this time. And it kind of brings me up to another question back to Mary. as you're saying, you know, they're talking about critical and non-critical cases. What can, like you were saying, from an Eastern perspective, to help naturally, right? The natural conception with, like you were saying, acupuncture, at-home acupuncture, supplements, anything that, you know, can help.
Yes. Yeah. And, you know, this is an opportunity. So, of course, when you hear, oh, you cannot go to the fertility clinic.
Yes.
The automatic reaction is like, whoa, how come I'm not deemed essential, right? We take it personally, and especially being a woman. And so that's why we're having this talk, because it's like, well, you know what? Let's pivot and let's shift our focus in another direction. Because if we can't physically get to the fertility clinic, well, what can I do proactively? What can I take back control of in my own hands as I go through this, right? And so this is an opportunity to, you know, if we need to work on your dietary habits, this is a time. If we're looking at, you know, either over-exercising, under-exercising, this is also the time. If we're looking at mental health stuff, this is the time to really check in and help start healing yourself from the inside out. And not just, and I'm not downplaying your role at all, Dr. Baratz, because, you know, I actually went through fertility treatment.
Yes, myself. That's right. Me too.
Yeah, exactly. So, and that's why we're so keen on the East meets West types of modalities, you know, together. We're bridging the gap, right? But, you know, if you can't get the treatment right now, it's an opportunity. And we know in follicular genesis, the development of eggs, it's going to take, you know, from a germ cell to the actual ovulating egg, it takes time. It's not just like when you go through that IVF cycle in the last 14 days. We want to start, I call it like, you know, juicing those up, the eggs a little bit, right? Before that time, let's prime them now. Yeah. And, you know, there's more and more research that's looking at even like supplements like CoQ10, PQQ, in terms of helping egg quality and the mitochondrial energy into the egg, right? So, you know, how about the food? How about our mental health? How about the exercise piece, right? How can that impact the health for our eggs? And then how about, you know, at this point, acupressure. Let's not say acupuncture.
Yeah, I said acupressure, but acupuncture. Yeah.
Do not attempt acupuncture on your own, please.
But I think that's an interesting something for you to elaborate a little further. But also, I want to get back to your mental health comment, where how do women who are trying to conceive keep their stress levels down? Because I do believe stress is a big factor in the fertility journey, right? So to keep it positive, and, you know, what kind of coping, what do you think about that? You know, okay. We need to keep it down.
Really, really great question. And I 100% agree. We want to limit and minimize our stress. But the very first thing I want to stress is that because you're stressed doesn't mean that you can't get pregnant.
Right. Okay, good.
There's conflicting research about this. It's like, oh, stress impacts your fertility. And then there's stress doesn't impact your fertility. So what is it? So really, my interpretation of that is stress, what we want to do is moderate it as much as we can, and then don't stress about being stressed. Because guess what? In life, we have stress. That's what keeps us going, right? Like when we have a heartbeat, it's up and down, up and down. So you don't want to have zero stress. That's a flat line.
Right.
So to live, you need some stress.
Right.
Right? And I know you're going to have a question later, and I'm going to I recommend a book.
Right. Yes. We're going to talk
about
that.
I'm not going to give it away yet.
Yeah.
But, and then, you know, so stress can be impacting your body, your physicality, your emotional state. But what's more important is how we deal with the stress. It's not the stress itself. Right. So then finding strategies on how to deal with the stress. And I'm really good with that. So that's why, you know, in fact, a lot of people will come to me, and you yourself have experienced this.
Yeah.
Where you come for acupuncture, but we end up talking more about life.
Yeah. And I could give an example. You know, one of the big things that resonated with me when I came to you, and I, you know, it still stays in my mind, make space for the baby. That is a huge statement that has just stayed with me. And I think that was my turning point, when I was like, okay, you know what? I thought I was making space for the baby, but actually I wasn't. So that, I think that's such an important comment that you said. And so I just kind of want to put that out there as well. And just, really make that space right now. Like, it's okay, you know, in this situation, and do your best.
Yeah, and you know what? People are forced to make space right now.
Yeah.
So it's actually not a bad thing, because it's kind of like
right.
you're forced into this place where you have to go back inside yourself. Right.
Yeah.
And reevaluate yeah. how you live your life.
Right.
You know, when you're, you know, doing all those things for fertility, how stressed are you doing that?
Exactly.
But I always
timelines.
Think, yeah, yeah, with the timelines, all the stress of like the self pressure, and then pressures from your in-laws, by the way, as well, right? Like, stuff like that. So it's like, how do we turn that around, and how do we really feed ourselves yeah. first?
Yeah, and I'm going to go back to Dr. Baratz again, just because you know, you were saying it's amazing how you ended it, and you said we're going to we're advocating, we're, you know, all the time. Do you see, is it a couple weeks at a time? Like, when do you see, I guess, the clinic reopening? Or is that a hard question right now to answer?
That is a difficult question.
Yeah.
Actually, I think that I would get yeah. more hits on Facebook if I had the answer for that.
I know.
But I think the clinic is really an extension of society. And so the question is, when will society
right.
pivot back, using your buzzword again, pivot, when will it pivot back to yeah. normal? Is this new normal? And so the real focus right now is to know that there is hope. Like, we know that we will
yeah.
beat the virus. We know that, like that. This state, the current state that we're in, is an abnormal state. It's not the new normal. It's a temporary place. But when you're a fertility patient, as you know very well, you see the world in terms of cycles. How many missed cycles am I having? And so that's really one of the foci of the telemedicine consult, is to identify any possibility for natural conception. So as experts, both Mary and myself, try and reflect back to and say, hey, look, you know, you've been trying for 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, but there's data that maybe that extra month may assist you. So keep going, because we are a few cycles away. Or I meet many people where we know they need more IVF. They need more fancy therapy, mm-hmm. high-level therapy. And we work together with Mary to really optimize not just natural conception, but optimize the next assisted conception. And so it actually doesn't even really matter when this ends, because everything you do now is going to optimize the back end. And I mean, obviously it matters to a certain extent. Like, we don't want to be like this for a year,
right?
18 months. I can tell you, from looking at all the data, from speaking to all the experts, mm-hmm. it looks like we're in this for at least a couple more months. I think that Premier Ford's statement of closing schools until May 6th is highly suggestive that new cycles will probably not start until the end of April or May. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean that you can't try to be pregnant. I mean, COVID is still a safe time to conceive. Most of the data coming out of pregnancy has been very, very reassuring. There are no significant numbers of harmed babies or fetal defects that we've noticed. For the most part, reproductive age women are in a younger age group, and we know that young women are not immune to COVID per se. They still get sick from it, but there is some age correlation, right? So they typically are healthier than people in their 50s, 60s, and 70s. So in terms of when it will end, because I was sort of skirting around your
answer. Yeah, I know.
The short answer is not soon enough, mm-hmm. but like any war or any battle, we have to be prepared for this uncomfortable state, and we have to get as comfortable as we can in it. And that's what I tell my patients is, mm-hmm. that's actually what the Navy SEALs tell their trainees. They say, you have to learn to be comfortable in this uncomfortable place. And so right. no one's trying to make it seem as if this is a good or comfortable place to be confined. We're social people. We want to be out there, yeah. even if it's at the fertility clinic. That connection is important, but work with the mindfulness, work with Mary.
Yes.
In fact, that's, if you ask me what books I would read, they're yeah. probably not so much fertility books. I mean, there are some probably
good ones. That's right. And that's where we're going to get to. Exactly.
But, I think all of the people that are writing about mindfulness right now, because, and I'm not a guru in any way, but I do subscribe to mindfulness, is we're in a certain state and we have to get as comfortable as we can in this place, because trying to fight out of it any earlier, breaking social distancing, not self-isolating, that's only going to harm us. And we know that with all the technology, all the fancy ventilators and maybe new medications and vaccines, new testing modalities. The most important thing to do right now to beat this virus is to stay away from each other. And that's an old technology, actually, but it's the most effective.
Okay. Well, that's a great segue, Dr. Baratz, into my next question. Obviously, being Book and Brunch, we're, again, an online platform, everything books and food. I was going to ask both of you to give, and it doesn't have to be, I started with fertility books, but it doesn't have to be that, but 1 to 2 book recommendations that you recommend reading during this time. So I'm going to start, go back to Mary.
So the first book that comes to mind, because we were talking about stress, is Kelly McGonigal. I don't know if you know her. She's a PhD, and she wrote, and this is unfortunately going to be backwards, The Upside of Stress.
Okay. Right?
And when I read it, I thought, oh my gosh, this is great, because they're adding science to what Chinese medicine has been talking about all along. Again, what I'm talking about, you know, we want to downregulate the sympathetic nervous system, meaning, you know, our response to stress. And the way she actually tells people to do that is kind of unique. I love it. It's like, oh, I'm feeling stressed. This is great. This is my body's way of telling me I am just rising to the occasion. Mm-hmm. And so I love that. And there's more to it. So check that out. And before I say another book, refer to another book, I just want to comment, Dr. Baratz, it's so great that you're talking about the uncomfortable bit, because when I was going through my fertility struggle, I would use, you know, a post-it note. I would write it down and I would say, I'm comfortable with being uncomfortable. And that was my mantra. I would have it like sticky note, literally on my mirror. So for those of you who likes strategy, I'm all about strategy. So literally you can write whatever your little mantra is to yourself and you post it on your mirror in the bathroom. I mean, this is a place that we definitely go to, or, you know, on your cell phone, because a lot of people will do that. Mm-hmm. And you can stick it on an alarm. Right? Like if you set an alarm, there's a place for notes and you can write whatever message you want for yourself. Right? I think I did that with you. I'm not sure in one of the sessions.
I think we talked about that. That was one of the strategy copies. It's a great strategy. And I always have one of my favorite quotes. I always have it kind of on my screensaver. So that's how I, and happy pictures. So that's kind of how I manage
my. That's awesome. So my second book, the second book that came to mind was The Biology of Belief by Bruce Lipton. He's a doctor as well. And basically talking about, you know, what you think can be manifested. And there are some research around that as well. So those are my two.
Thank you. Dr. Baratz?
So obviously I have two sides to my preferences for books. One are like the technical books. Mm-hmm. I think when it comes to fertility technical care, I suggest you relegate a lot of that to your provider because they can help direct that. But I think any pregnancy manual these days has a few chapters on fertility in the first trimester. So it might be good to read What to Expect When You're Expecting or one of those type manuals, because they definitely talk about pre-pregnancy planning, optimizing natural fertility. So that's more of a technical read. Stylistic, I think the books, like I've read a few recently that really do motivate me. I think, you know, Angela Duckworth wrote a book called Grit, excellent book about high performance, but it can be applied to anybody in terms of how to achieve. And there's a few great books on mindfulness that I read recently. There's one that I think was a very thin book. It was written by a newscaster last name Harris, and it's called 10% Happier.
Yes.
And I thought that was a great book for a few reasons. A, if you have a short attention span, it's very short. If you're not ready to read a big volume on mindfulness, then it's a great survey. And it really does break it down into not trying to achieve complete bliss. I mean, that's really a very difficult state to achieve. And complete enlightenment is something that we all strive for, but getting that tiny bit happier, just, you know, right now, a lot of us are down. So I think that's a great book. I think it was actually a bestseller. So those are the books that I would look at. I know they sound in some ways from a medical Western doctor, a little soft,
but
in these days, I think these are the books that are really going to help all of us get through. And if that doesn't work, I think Netflix has got some great, I'm not going to say what I like because I don't want people to judge me, but there's some very interesting stuff on there.
That's awesome. Yeah, and it's about the motion, right? I mean, yes, there's technical things, and I think people are more right now about the emotion. And I mean, I said this in the beginning of the live, one of my favorites is Mary's Pathway to Pregnancy. One of the books that changed me and just gave me a lot of hope and positivity for the fertility journey. It's just a beautifully written book of fertility case studies and hope in those fertility case studies. And I really call it the chicken soup for the pregnancy soul. So you guys really, you know, it's a quick read. I read it in a day and a half, and it just gave me a lot of hope. And then that's kind of where the question was like, you know, make space for the baby and a lot of that stuff. I think that was one of the case studies in there as well that I remember. But yeah, that's, you know, one of the best books I've read last year for that. And it's a mix of, it's emotional, it's hopeful, it's positive. And also just on our website, bookandbrunch.com, so book, the letter N, and brunch.com, we have also quite a few different reads that are inspirational, ground you, soothe you in this time in self-isolation, just to help through. And, you know, there's technical and there's fiction, nonfiction, there's all different types of books. So there's quite a few comments and questions. So we're going to go into our Q&A, and I'm just going to read that from the Facebook Live. So I'm just going to scroll through some of that. They've just been piling up as we go. So we're going to give ourselves, we're just going to get through them 10 to 15 minutes and see. Oh, see, I'm scrolling so many of them. So this is from Tamara, and her question is, will there be any priority for women with diminished ovarian reserve or women approaching menopause like me who's 44 years old?
Thank you. Is that for me?
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
Yes, it's for you, Dr. Barasa. Okay. I mean, they're not saying that, but that would make sense.
thank you for the question, Tamara. So as I was trying to emphasize, at the highest levels, there is recognition that fertility cases do have differing levels of urgency. And so your fertility provider will be able to assess that. Obviously, you have insight into it, commenting on the low egg reserve. So there will have to be some level of priority. When that will happen, unfortunately, I can't give you a specific date. The question will always be, what is the best pathway for women in their mid-40s? And that's something that will have to be reevaluated in the coming months when your clinic is open again, and you can meet with your provider. But you also may want to book a telemedicine follow-up with your provider to see if there's something you can do in the interim, maybe working with Mary Wong, maybe taking some supplements to help preserve the reserve that you have.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Barasz. Okay, this is from Louise, and this is for Dr. Barasz again. I went through cycles in Northern Alberta with Dr. Barasz. Had a great local and distant team. Have a healthy 2.5-year-old thanks to Create. Telemedicine worked well for my family. So that's a beautiful comment.
Right, so I can respond. Thank you, Louise. So as I was saying, like, telemedicine is kind of interesting that in Eastern medicine, which I think of as more of a empiric classical area of medicine, been around much longer than Western medicine, is Mary's now reinventing herself with the telemedicine, whereas Western medicine has been using telemedicine for a while. So it's interesting how we're all learning from each other, but I've always enjoyed telemedicine. To me, it's the highest form of outreach to reach people that are isolated. Canada is an interesting country because we are so Southern focused and all of our Northern register is really underserviced. I mean, the fact that someone from Northern Alberta is coming all the way to downtown Toronto, it was a great experience. And I've helped people from all over. I think every province has come to our center, and I know there are other providers that enjoy it. So thank you, Louise, for that comment, and be well and be COVID safe.
This is from Linda, and this is a comment from Mary. I love talking to you, Mary, during my acupuncture sessions. It does help me with my stress.
Thank you, Linda. That's so great.
That's so lovely. Okay, so this is for from Addie. This is for in general. Firstly, thank you guys for these sessions. They're enlightening. Regarding priority cases, this will be probably coming to you, Dr. Barasz. Will be there a consideration for those with high autoimmunity diseases, which are highly challenging, very low egg reserve towards the phase of perimenopause and age 40?
So as per the previous comment, Some conditions are definitely based on urgency. Unfortunately, some conditions are not affected by time, right? So autoimmunity is something that's with us. If someone has it, it's probably constitutional. It's been with you since you were born, likely, or intensifies over your lifetime. The low leg reserve obviously is time sensitive. And no one is trying to say that we're in a perfect situation. I mean, there will be women who will have to be prioritized, and as a consequence, some people will be pushed behind. Unfortunately, that hierarchy will be determined by your fertility clinic. And as I said before, I think it's very important for anyone that's having any level of anxiety about their position or their treatment and hasn't spoke to their provider in more than 2 or 3 months, I think it's a great time to set up an appointment or seek an opinion.
Thank you. This is, again, for Dr. Baratz from Tanya. What treatments are REs able to still give through telemedicine?
Thank you for that question, Tanya. Is it Tanya or Tanya?
Tanya.
I always mess that one up.
YA. But,
thank you, Tanya. Tanya. So first of all, the telemedicine consult will allow your provider to identify what the most obvious reason for failed conception is. And if it's amenable to prescription-based therapy, like an oral medication, then that's something that we're very able to do from the telemedicine perspective. If the condition is something that requires advanced technologies, unfortunately, that group will not benefit from the telemedicine. But interestingly, there are many conditions and many situations where lifestyle modification, again, enhancement through Eastern medicine with Mary Wong, or personal pre-pregnancy optimization can work. So I'm speaking in very general terms, but again, a telemedicine consult or reflecting on a previous consult may remind you of things that you have to do, whether it's optimizing weight, blood pressure, blood sugar. These are all things that can be done from a distance. And they all need an exception.
Right. So further to that question, I think you answered it. There's no cycle monitoring. All treatments are on hold. Okay.
So to be specific, yes, the clinics cannot engage in any kind of diagnostic procedure. So that means even ultrasounds, which are the mainstay of fertility care, fertility clinics. But again, if pre-existing scans can be interpreted, if a person's having regular menstrual cycles, that can also be interpreted. And there are home monitoring kits. There are home ovulation kits. There are some talks on the internet that discuss those. You can buy those at your pharmacy. There are apps that help provide support. There actually are even home sperm tests that you can buy online. Some of them are not the most well-validated, but again, in very coarse terms, if you just want a qualitative assessment, they may be helpful. So you can carve together a fairly reasonable first level assessment. Again, we're not formally advocating these because this is new territory for all of us, but a consultation will help identify what we can do and what we can't do.
So if someone's in the middle of a cycle of monitoring treatment, like you said, that's still continuing, can you prescribe medication?
Yeah, so what we're trying to do with all of our patients, I can't speak for other clinics, but we're always looking one or two cycles ahead. So any of my ongoing cycles, I'm instructing my patients I'm giving them prescription for medications that I think will work with them while they're not being monitored, that are safe. And we're also always available for follow-up email or teleconsult to refine that instruction. But it's very reasonable for 2 or 3 months to be on some type of oral medication, assuming all things are normal, like sperm and fallopian tubes, et cetera.
Right. So having more of, obviously not the psychomonitoring medication, just to be clear, it's the, you could still prescribe oral medication.
I mean, you could prescribe injectable medication, but the problem with those drugs are that if you're naive to the drug, if you've never been on it, then it can be very difficult to predict the response. So there may be certain circumstances where your provider would be comfortable prescribing injectable drugs. The only issue is they'd have no way of assessing the response. And with injectable drugs, which are usually very costly, I mean, Mary's very comfortable giving needles, but usually fertility drugs are very costly, and we don't want to needlessly use those. So there's going to be some lost cycles, there's no question, but if there's any opportunity to salvage them, your provider could help figure that out for you.
Okay. So I want to cut in and ask a question then. In terms of then things like letrozole or Clomid on the front end or progesterone on the back end, are you prescribing that through telemedicine?
Yes, I think those are great. Well, I mean, again, all those drugs need to be prescribed in consultation with a healthcare professional as appropriate. But those are great drugs because, first of all, for the most part, they have a very good side effect profile for most women. Number two is they typically have a stereotypical response, that they don't typically lead to hyperstimulation, and they're unlikely to result in multigestation, like twins or triplets, et cetera. So, and they're drugs that we have a lot of experience giving without cycle monitoring. So they have, and they're not that costly either. So there are many features that are perfectly designed for remote provision and with a very safe track record. So those are the classic examples. But other drugs that might be prescribed, maybe metformin for women that have PCOS, ovarian supplements for women with low egg reserve, and then any other comorbid medication, like maybe if a woman has low thyroid, she might need some thyroid medication. So these are blood pressure medication. Like, these are medications that maybe your primary care provider or your fertility specialist or your gynecologist may want to initiate. And this is a great time to set those up so that when you come back to the fertility clinic, you're ready to go.
Awesome. Okay. That answered quite a few questions. Okay. This is for Mary. Are you doing phone appointments?
Yes. And so that's what I was discussing. We can teach you how to do some self-acupressure points. And in fact, we may even be able to mail you out some acupressure, it's like little sticker tabs, and it could be surgical steel. And in fact, I'm also looking at this other one. It's very interesting. So this is a science experiment for myself. I love science, so I love being my own guinea pig. But this, it's called acupatching. And what it is it's heat activated. So your body heat activates this phototherapy. So it's like light that gets activated through this patch. So I just want to check it out myself before I give it off to anyone. But I find it very interesting because it's not that different from low level laser therapy, which I do see an impact. And there's lots of studies on that. So I'm going to check that out. But yes. And then otherwise, it's like old school acupressure massage, right? Okay. I would teach you on the spot, right? And then again, with the support through lifestyle, dietary habits, and the mental health aspect. So absolutely. And I'm not the only one. There are other people doing telehealth. And actually, I want to credit Dr. Baratz. He says, you should call it teleholistic medicine. And I'm like, wow, that's really great. THM, guys. Okay. So it's available.
Okay. And that was, if I didn't mention, that was from Stephanie, who's asking that question.
Oh, thanks, Stephanie. Yes, we're totally available for you.
Okay. This is back to Dr. Baratz from Linda. Good evening, Dr. Baratz. My doctor just made a referral to you yesterday. How long will I expect to wait to see you?
Is that from Linda?
Yes.
Oh, Linda, thank you so much for the interest in our practice. Again, another great question. So I wish I could do my own booking. I do have a team of administrators that book for me. I'd like to say, I think it's going to be in the next couple of months. We usually see people within about 6 to 8 weeks of a referral, which is pretty standard for a busy fertility practice. We have a very active cancellation list. So especially now, we're opening up more slots. So the short answer is likely in the next couple of months, probably before COVID ends, maybe. But please call our office and they can help you find an earlier slot if it's not acceptable in terms of timeline.
Okay. So another question from Valerie, it could be addressed to both Mary and Dr. Baratz. What are your thoughts on high intensity exercise and long distance running during fertility treatments?
Mary, do you want to start?
Okay. Well, you know, if you were the person that was a long distance runner and you've been doing it your whole life and it's like, doesn't even like break a sweat, then maybe it's okay for you. But, you know, I always ask people to self-gauge, and we don't want people to do anything extreme. So you're certainly not going to, as you're trying to conceive, you're not going to start something new. Like, I don't recommend that in terms of high intensity of any kind. But how you self-gauge is when you do this exercise, after you're done, are you more tired? Do you feel invigorated? How are you feeling? Do you feel guilty? Right? So we have to look at the emotional and the physical aspect of the impact. And, you know, certainly when someone is going through like IVF stimulation and their ovaries are physically getting heavy, it's like, no, you don't want to do any of that. But right now you're in that downtime. So you're not going to have that. Even if you're taking some Clomid or Letrozole, actually, unless you're PCOS, but that's a whole different conversation, right? So, you know, ideally we want things that are more relaxed based, right? To heal body and mind. So that's why we love to tell people to do yoga, brisk walks and connect with nature. But it's not that you can't do any excessive or more hardcore exercise. I remember years ago, and she's actually in my book, and she was a long distance marathon runner, and she was also running like crazy in every direction. She worked for the government, very high profile job. And I said, you know, we just need to like, just tone it down a little, right? Because for her, stress relief is through this extreme exercise. I said, okay, well, instead of running 20 miles, can you just like run 10? Right? So she did, she lowered it, but she didn't stop. And in the end, she did get pregnant. But so the point is, you know, self-gauge and be moderate for you. Is that clear?
So Dr. Baratz?
So Mary and I have talked about this quite a bit, and we have many shared patients and clients that have that, you know, dual interest. They want to get pregnant, but they want to maintain activity. And definitely the main principle is know your baseline, and that's what you should be working towards. So I have many patients that are elite athletes where like their cooling it down is way more intense than any of us could ever achieve. And then I have many you know, weekend warriors who all of a sudden decide that they have this goal of running the Boston Marathon. And so we try to bring them back to what a baseline should be. I mean, Health Canada guidelines for physical activity in conception is pretty modest. It's about 5 sessions of 30 minutes at a time per week. So 150 minutes per week of intensity that you're comfortable with. That's usually the terminology they use, but we usually say to be able to talk throughout the workout, because that's an intensity that's good. One thing that I think high intensity athletes should be very aware of, because that was where the question came from, is there is some data that the recovery phase for a high intensity athlete, like someone who's run a marathon, their immune system may be very susceptible. So I'm telling all of, I'm not seeing a lot of face-to-face patients right now, but people who are elite or, you know, running marathons, especially now in the face of COVID, for a couple of days afterwards, they have done studies looking at the blood immune system, and it does look compromised in that post couple day state. And there's a lot of physiologists support that. So again, these are usually people that are pretty fit to begin with. But I would caution anyone against, I mean, all the big marathons have been canceled anyway now because of the crowds that are associated with it. But I think there may be something else behind it. So my advice is now is the wrong time to be pushing for a personal best, A, from the COVID side, and B, from the fertility side. But in general, we definitely encourage activity. To me, it's all about BMI as well. We don't want a BMI that's too high or too low. So extremes of BMI, they can be very toxic to ovulation. So fitness is really a sweet spot. And that's, again, something that Mary and her team have worked really well with. Nutritionists, athletic trainers are excellent. That's a great thing to be working on right now. Physical fitness, almost every gym that I've heard of is doing two great things. Number one is they're suspending all fees. Like they're not charging you for the gym fee that was on the news today. And number two is they're all offering online classes. So what better opportunity to do that? So I think, and they're all offering really great, high-end, excellent led classes that are free subscription, you know, or a trial free that's for about 60, 90 days. So that's something I really promote right now.
Yeah, and I personally worked out, I had a personal trainer before the fertility treatments, and I worked out through my fertility treatments as well, and I'm continuing to work out during my pregnancy. So again, as you guys mentioned, it's in moderation for what makes sense for you. And I like what you said, Dr. Baratz, you have to be make sure you're still talking when you're working out. That's a great tidbit. All right, we have another question for Dr. Baratz. What does Dr. Baratz think about acupuncture? Do you think it really, do you think it really helps in improving egg quality?
So first of all—
And that's from Nazar.
Nazar, thank you for that question. You're speaking to a very biased audience because obviously I'm a big fan, but I've been following acupuncture for about 20 years. I've been watching the early data that was coming out, And from the beginning, I was always very impressed with two things. Number one, there really aren't a convincing number of articles that show that it's harmful. And there are some articles, some large meta-analyses that actually showed some benefit. So for me, that's always, those are two really attractive features. And then the third feature is there are other secondary benefits, right? So we talked about stress reduction, we talked about mindfulness, and acupuncture really is a way of putting you in that zone. So in spending time with professionals like Mary and other professionals, I really, I was not trained formally in acupuncture, but I've developed a very strong appreciation for it. And to me, the thing I was telling, I've worked with other patients saying to them that there's only so much I can do. And if I've reached the end of what I can do, why would you not seek out other modalities to help you? Any person that's dealing with any kind of problem always looks left and right, right? You always look around, try to identify what are the hazards, what are the obstacles, and what are the things that, what are the opportunities? And it's what a great relationship. Mary and I probably speak at least weekly about cases. And that's an excellent, and there are many other examples of Eastern and Western providers working together. How does it work? Well, Mary will have to comment on that. I think all of its mechanisms have not fully been established, but certainly there are some that make sense. And I think I'll let Mary comment further. But the one thing I am going to say, though, is I didn't tell you the total truth. I am an acupuncturist. I'm an egg acupuncturist because when I do ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injection, we inject sperm right into the egg. And that's the most fundamental cellular level acupuncture that you can perform.
So. Yeah, and I don't have any training in that, that's for sure. So that's pretty awesome. You can't do it right now.
Right. Yeah. So this is a comment from Tanya, YA. And this is for both. Overtraining and overextending yourself can cause shorter menstrual cycles, really unhealthy for the yin deficiency type, right, Mary?
Absolutely.
Question. Yeah.
And that's why, you know, we look at how do we self-gauge? And she's absolutely right. One of the ways to self-gauge is, does it impact your menstrual cycle? And we know, right? Like some extreme athletes, or high BMI or low BMI can impact your menstrual cycle in a negative way, right? You can become completely anovulatory. Your menstrual cycles can disappear. So is that good? Is that helpful for fertility? Probably not, because you're not ovulating.
Right.
Anovulatory.
And then the comment further goes, but then on the other hand, high intensity interval can be supportive for PCOS patients.
Yes. But again, yeah. Did you want to comment on the PCOS, Dr. Baratz?
What I wanted to say was that I just lost my train of thought. I'll let you go back. Well, anyway, training does help for PCOS. Oh, this is what I was going to say. Sorry, I remember. You know, one way of looking at menstrual cycles is primary disturbances of menstrual cycles versus secondary disturbances. So primary disturbances are those that you're born with. You have some kind of constitution, some type of genetic makeup that from day one, when women went into menarche, her cycles were always irregular, and probably training may or may not influence that. You will likely require some kind of fertility specialist to assist with that. Secondary menstrual irregularities, those that develop over time, those that were normal at once then became abnormal, those are very amenable to training modification because there's clearly something that happened either in body habitus, diet, exercise that influenced that. So that's again a key point to discuss with your provider to help identify which category are you in. Are you in someone that has always been this way? Are you someone that developed it? And very often many women have been on some type of contraceptive for a good 5, 10, 15 years of their life. And whether it's the birth control pill, patch, IUD, NuvaRing, all of those mask constitution. They mask what your real cycles are meant to do. So gynecologists or fertility specialists can help sort out that. PCOS, back to PCOS, there's no question that PCOS benefits from activity. There's a variant of PCOS, the thin PCOS, that may not benefit as much. But in general, PCO women, for the most part, the most common forms of it, benefit from activity and weight loss.
And so continuing from Tanya, the comment, it would vary based on the individual, but I would consider taking a couple days off and then continue whatever you're doing exercise-wise, just to further that, what she was saying with the comment. Okay, so from Monica, how about exercise after an embryo transfer if you're an athlete? Who wants to take that one on? Mary, Dr. Baratz?
I'll grab the first part of that, okay, and I'll let Mary close it. So traditionally, we thought, because IVF's been around for 40 years, so traditionally we thought a woman was very fragile after embryo transfer, that she couldn't be touched, she had to lie down for 20 minutes after transfer, don't move her. And then we realized that that probably doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense from a physiology perspective, and it doesn't make sense from just a practical perspective, right? You kind of want to get up and go. When you go to a fertility clinic, you'll see there's a certain flow that has to happen there. And if you had everyone lying down, it would really be quite stagnant. So there are some papers that have supported early mobility, even after a transfer, like within minutes of a transfer, we get people up right away. We don't have them lie down. In terms of what happens in the days and weeks during the 2-week wait, it's pretty much in line with the recommendations that Mary was commenting on. That's what I advise. No new programs, no training for a triathlon if you've never done it before. Pretty much limiting weight lifting to about 15, 20 pounds, and then following the instructions of your provider, because you may have other conditions that they want to manage through activity. So there'll be instructions that follow your transfer. I'll leave it, let Mary comment further.
What struck me right with what you said is, you know, no lifting weights, you know, 15, 20 pounds. And I want to address that for those people that actually have children, because who experienced the secondary infertility or, you know, had primary infertility and came around again for the second one, right? And so there's a fear, oh my gosh, I'm not supposed to lift, but I have a baby, what do I do? So they literally tried not to touch their baby. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is bad, right? So one thing I say is like, okay, listen, it's not like you've never lifted 15, 20 pounds now, because you're used to lifting this child every single day, like multiple times, like, no, all the time, really. So you know how to leverage, you know how to help yourself so that you can carry the baby appropriately. So yes, of course, you know, you can modify the way you do it. You can make it be limited, but you're not going to stop lifting your child ever, right? So just know that you can. But if you're the other camp, however, like if you don't do any of that ever, then no, you're not going to all of a sudden start doing weight lifting and, you know, doing 20 pounds or whatever, right? Uh-oh, someone's coming in. This is a challenge.
We have a couple more questions. They just keep on rolling in, so I hope you guys are okay with that. So yeah, thank you for both answering that. I would just want to go back. Tanya Wild is a naturopathic doctor, so she's also on this chain. And so that last comment, she did answer Monica's question. She said it would vary based on the individual, but I'd consider taking a couple of days off and then continue whether you're doing exercise, whatever you're doing exercise-wise. Okay, so there's two more questions. So again,
I just want to follow that up.
Yeah.
You meant after an embryo transfer to take a few days off?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, one could do that. I mean, look, everything that we do is wrapped in a certain circumstance. You know, people are superstitious about certain things. And to a certain extent, I do have a soft spot for superstition. I mean, you don't want to be held accountable for a failed transfer because you were walking on your hands all the time. I mean, every type of discipline, whether it's yoga, basketball, hockey, HIIT training, there probably are, if you were to engage the trainer, the coach, they would say, yes, there are certain things you can and can't do if you were pregnant. So for example, in yoga, inversions are very debated in terms of putting your head in your heart. So the best thing anyone can do for themselves if they're really interested in physical activity is engaging a professional, like a trainer, and they can advise. But formally being on rest for 2-3 days, I think that would be a personal decision. But if someone was to take a brisk walk, light jog, and if that transfer failed, I don't think I'd be able to blame the failed transfer on that. So we have to make sure we place accountability where it should be. I mean, very often women and men feel responsible for every time they coughed or sneezed, that's why the embryo fell out. And I always remind patients that there's a lot going on here that's well beyond what you're doing. And one move here, one move there is not lifting your baby. That's not what's going to do you in. There's a higher mechanism at play that you can't really control.
Right. So she further just follows up with that, just said, studies do say that continuing your exercise, as you said, program increases your chances of IVF success, and maintaining what you are doing is encouraged, but scale back as pregnancy progresses because of chances of injury. That's right. So that's what you said. But I just feel energetically take a day off for IVF.
So to add in, if you don't mind me jumping in now.
Yeah.
So thank you, Dr. Baratz, for adding that in, because I think it's so important. And one of the things I always say is, you know, you're asking me this question and I want you to ask yourself, because you know your body and you know yourself best. And so if you were to take this on, and that's actually considered the worst case scenario, if it does fail, are you going to be blaming it on that? And so some women will actually say, right, okay, I know the answer then. I don't want to engage in that. And other people say, no, I will totally be fine. Like you, Zuzana. Yeah. You're like, no, absolutely. I'm going to keep on going.
Yeah, exactly. That was why, you're right. We had that discussion and you said the same thing to me. And I was like, no, I feel great. I'm going to continue to do that. So it's what you guys were saying. It's how people are feeling, their personal, you know, thing. And someone just wrote, LOL, so true. People think that embryos can fall out and won't even shower. So important. Thanks for saying that, Dr. Baratz. So
please, I definitely recommend showering. actually, as an anecdote, just to make sure everyone knows that people that are out of the house and actually going to the going to clinics to work are actually asked to shower when they come home from work.
Right.
I mean, that's become part of the reality. So, we're joking a bit about showering, but there's many people, like a lot of the healthcare providers are showering 4 or 5 times a day now just because of COVID to keep themselves clear.
Okay. It just keeps on coming. So I hope you guys are okay with continue with some more questions.
Are you providing coffee, Zuzana? Or are you...
No, you guys have your water. So
I'm running low.
Are you guys running low? So, you know, every time I have a couple more, there's more coming in. So this is from Jay. Dr. Baratz, I've had 3 miscarriages, likely due to miscarriage. I'm wondering if I try naturally, if I have a higher risk of having another miscarriage.
That's a fantastic question, Jay. Thank you for that. So very often we're focused on the infertility patient, and sometimes we don't discuss recurrent pregnancy loss as much. What's interesting about recurrent pregnancy loss is, and again, you'd have to meet with your provider to discuss it, but aside from the diagnosis, whether it's a maternal-based diagnosis or an embryonic diagnosis, there is a natural history to miscarriage that does allow for success over time. Meaning, there are people who unfortunately miscarry multiple times and at some point will have a successful baby. Now, not all diagnoses are consistent with that. And we do know that if women have not had a successful baby and are miscarrying, the chance of another miscarriage is much higher than those who've had a successful baby. So you have to take your own history and see if you've been successful before with a child or not. But I think that's another great example of something you can do in the next couple months. I don't want to give false medical advice, meaning there may be aspects to your care that I am not aware of. But the first question I would ask is, I guess, do you want to be pregnant the next year? That's always the first question. Number two is, have you had a full baby before, live healthy baby? If you have, and you've had 2 or 3 miscarriages, it's not unreasonable to try one more time during this waiting period. Again, with doctor's advice. If you haven't had a live birth and you've had 3 consistent miscarriages, you might want to take a break until you see a provider.
Okay. So from Jay, this is a shout out to Mary. She gave me acupuncture 3 years ago and 2 months later, I was pregnant with my son. She's amazing.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Jay. So glad to hear you. It's so awesome that you're following up and watching this and telling me about your child. I didn't know. Thank you.
All right. So Jay says, I've had a healthy baby and yes, I want to get pregnant next year. To answer your question.
I think the next step would be to meet with someone like myself and reconnect with Mary and look at your medical file. And maybe there's something in there that suggests why you're miscarrying. It's a bit of detective work. We have to look and see, again, just like I mentioned about irregular cycles, recurrent pregnancy loss can be divided into primary and secondary, primary being those that have never conceived before versus secondary, people who have had a full baby and are having miscarriages after that. So It sounds like you're a secondary case. My advice is connect with Mary ASAP and find someone like myself or another telemedicine provider, and we'll get you moving forward.
Awesome. Okay. Where are we? There's so many. Okay, here we go.
We can't answer all of them. We can't keep on going all night. I'm just going to say.
No, there's a couple more. We'll finish it off with a couple more. Okay. And then that is
Zuzana. It. Zuzana, yeah. Can I say something?
Sure.
This is on Facebook?
Yep.
So if anyone leaves hanging questions, either Mary or myself can go to the Facebook later.
Yes.
And we can try and answer some of them too. Is it on Facebook on Book and Brunch?
No, it's on a live.
Oh, it's going to live, yeah. So that's, I think that might be the...
And then, we'll finish off with a couple more because we've been going for an hour now. So I am going to... Okay, hi, this is from Rianne. This is back to Dr. Baratz. I'm currently waiting for my consult. How does your clinic manage patients living in Windsor, so remotely? Do you have satellite clinics for monitoring, or would you just drive to Toronto?
Is that Rianne or Brianne?
Rianne.
So thank you for the interest, Rianne. For the first consult, you would probably either do a teleconsult. So as I said, we were doing those even before COVID. So we would offer you a teleconsult. And then we do have a small satellite in London, which may be helpful for some parts of your cycle. But for the actual more invasive procedures, IVF egg retrieval, embryo transfer, you would have to come to Toronto for that part. That's where our lab is. But we could use a satellite for part of it.
So just two more questions here and a comment, and then we'll finish up. So this is back to Dr. Baratz again. Thanks so much for your time and patience as I'm asking these questions on behalf of my wife and trying to be patient. Is there an age limit for IUI and IVF with high AMH?
So the short answer is, and long answer to that question, the short answer is there is no formal age limit for any fertility treatments, but there definitely are success limits. And we know that age is directly related to success. Unfortunately, fertility treatments are very ageist in that regard, in terms of success. Again, that's something that you would discuss with your provider. The government of Ontario funded IVF program does cut off at the age of 43. So that's one age limit, but there is no age limit for IUI. The problem is that at a certain point, even if you're allowed to perform the IUI, how successful will it be? And most fertility treatments start to taper off after 43. And that's where one would start considering other, you know, alternatives. But again, one size doesn't fit all. There are many women that are in their early 40s and have success. And there's many women in their 20s and 30s who are still struggling. So for a more detailed answer, you'd have to meet with your provider.
Okay. Thank you. So finally, question for...
I have a question. Actually, I have a question. For Mary, does Mary have an age limit to what she does?
Ooh, that's a good question.
In Chinese medicine, the proper answer is when you're menstruating, then there is some chance. And so if you have zero menstruation, then maybe there isn't a chance. Well, and that is also dependent on age. And so if you have not had a menstrual cycle and you're 37 and like ever, then we could still maybe work with you and see if we can help trigger your brain to cause an ovulation. But, you know, we always say we need to delve into the Western science as well, because we might need to integrate and let's see if we can induce periods, right? But if you're fully in menopause, then no, we can't help you, right? Science can help you there.
Right.
We could do donor egg and all that stuff, right? But we can't. So there are limitations, absolutely. But if you have a period and, you know, like the oldest naturally that we've dealt with is 48 and having babies, but I'm not going to say this is going to happen for you at all because the chances are so slim, but simultaneously we have seen it, but I don't want a whole bunch of 48-year-olds now knocking on my door. I just want to say.
Right.
That's really a very important point that Mary made, that we should, just for the age comment, because it came up, which is that just because someone's older doesn't mean they can't conceive, but it may be, there might be limitations on what technology can do. And that's really something you have to discern between, because you don't want to be providing a care that is futile, right? What we do does cost emotional currency, financial currency. It's expensive, and we have to be very prudent with how we use it. So we don't discriminate. Like, we want to meet as many people as possible, but we also want to make sure that we're advocating on all fronts.
And if I might add in, if you don't mind, Dr. Baratz, because some technology, as you say, is ageist. So, you know, if you have high FSH, then IVF with drugs is not necessarily your best protocol, right? No. And you might be better off doing an IUI then. So, but in Chinese medicine, we can still work on you in other ways, because we're not doing, as I always say, you know, Western science works more on the numbers, and we want to help work more on the quality.
Okay. So there's this overall question when you guys are talking about telemedicine. And I think people are wondering this, so I'm going to put it up. Would you guys consider doing a telemedicine consultation together? Have someone asked for that?
Wow.
So I'll just answer that. So, you know, one of the issues with telemedicine in Ontario is that it's an OHIP provided service. Right. So you actually, if you have a referral from your family doctor,
I see.
It's my time is covered. Mary's time is different. She has her own system. But essentially, you are getting a double consult, because not exclusively to Mary, but I'm always trying to probe my patients and see where I can help them as a whole person. Right. So if you believe in patient-centered medicine, then by definition, you believe in Eastern medicine, Western medicine. You believe in every tool that's out there. So really trying to look at not just the disease of infertility, but the unique illness experience, their feelings, their ideas. And a lot of that I work with, but a lot of that Mary will work with. So we've never done like a side consult, but we've definitely shared many, many, many patients. I believe that some of my patients were in pathways to pregnancy. In fact, a little plug for Mary, one of my most touching moments as a provider was when she invited me to come to her book launch. And then a few of her patients that were in the book approached me. And it was such an incredible experience, because some of them, I had worked exclusively on them, and then Mary kind of was the closer. And some of them, I actually had not been able to work with them to a certain point, and Mary was able to be successful. So short answer is, yes, we work together. Long answer is, it'll be in two separate appointments.
Okay, that's the question. Is there a chance to have a combined appointment? So no, based on OHIP.
But okay. We refer to each other all the time.
Yes, you work with each other. So these are just like a couple comments, and then we're going to close it off. I've had 3 miscarriages, 2 chemicals, and conceived naturally over Christmas break, but I already had a baby. So definitely try naturally if there's no medical reason not to, and definitely see Mary to help you. So that's a good comment. That's from Tanya. And Julie just said, thank you for mentioning about able to lift my little one. Had a transfer today, and that was a discussion with my husband and I today about if I could or not. So thank you for answering that for me. I think, yeah. Mary, you mentioned that. And then just a final question from everybody, for both of you, is how are you social distancing? They want to know, Dr. Baratz, Mary, how are you social distancing? And then we're going to close it off.
Well, I'm at home. I'm not going to the office at all. And I believe Dr. Baratz is going to the office. So I am, you know, doing the social distancing as recommended by the government, and I had closed down my office April 17. Okay. So
just talk about
I had two newborn nieces in the last 2 weeks, and I haven't met them, so to me that's social distance. I have parents that are in their 70s. I've waved at them from a distance, but I haven't, hugged them at all or anything. And the only people I'm in direct contact with are the people I cohabitate with, like my family, my wife and kids. At work, I do go to work because I do have some essential service I have to provide, but we screen every day at our clinic. So we go through a questionnaire. We use, most of our staff are wearing masks. Any frontline people are wearing the N95 masks. So we're doing our best to protect yourself. I'm exclusively doing telemedicine. We are not doing any face-to-face consultation. Oops. Hello?
We're here.
Sorry. I was there. Sorry. I'm the only face-to-face consult are emergencies. So if I have any early pregnancies, so that means I went from seeing 60 to 80 people a day down to like 2. Okay. So I think that for me, unfortunately, social distancing is not perfect for everybody, right? There are frontline providers that are in the way of harm, and that's why it's so important that we give them their social distance so they don't have to work more than they need to.
Yeah. And back to Mary, I was just going to say, just if you guys could quickly summarize, which you did, Dr. Ruff, thank you for that, what you're currently doing with telemedicine. Mary, you're taking calls because those are a lot of the questions that we had. And obviously, Dr. Ruff, your clinic's taking calls as well for referrals from doctors. Yeah, just summarize quickly what's available for fertility patients.
Well, all the social media platforms need to, I mean, unfortunately, I don't think any clinic has a comprehensive blast to all of their clients. Right. So it's very important that before coming to the clinic that everyone checks the website of your clinic, the voicemail, the email, all the emails have an auto reply on them, and all the social media platforms like Facebook, Instagram. I think that's the one interesting area about, I would say, this pandemic versus SARS is during SARS, we didn't have what we have today in terms of communication. Like, we're all very connected. So we are using all of those platforms all the time. And that's how you know whether the clinic's accessible or not, through email and voicemail.
Okay, thanks. And Mary, what's alive?
So I have already been doing some telemedicine even prior, because I have patients that are quite far away, right? So like Labrador or British Columbia, Dubai. But now it's like, okay, this has become more of a primary. And so now adding to it would be the acupressure piece, which I actually hadn't thought of before. And, you know, looking, because we are forced to look at it, it's like, wow, it can actually be quite effective. So that's why I'm adding it in, because before I wasn't when I was doing my telemedicine consults, but I will definitely add that in. Yeah.
So that's great.
And you can contact clinic@aliveholistichealth.ca for appointments. And me and my team are ready to provide that service. We also have a hypnosis practitioner that is providing service for that, because everybody needs a level of calm right now. And for those of you who have missed it, we had an amazing, amazing webcast yesterday. It was 2 hours long, which this is becoming.
We're done with questions, though.
Okay, good.
We're just summarizing up.
Yeah. And so you can get a chance to get the replay for that, because it was really powerful. And as I mentioned in the beginning of the post today, that, you know, someone commented and said, this was like so fantastic, and I feel so calm and at ease, like I've had an acupuncture session. So check it out. And that's free. But, you know, you can definitely contact us for an actual consult one-on-one, so that we can provide you individualized care.
So just for our clinic, again, if you're from Ontario and have an OIP card, your family doctor can send a referral. Any international or non-Ontario patients can just contact our, we have an intake email, and just, you know, briefly summarize what you're looking for. And we have 4 fertility doctors that do consultation. So I have I'm in a partnership with 4 doctors. We have an army of nurses, and unfortunately now we've become a little contracted because of COVID, but we're ready when COVID ends. So you reach out to us, and we're more than happy to meet with you via telemedicine.
Great. Thank you so much for your time today. These questions are amazing. And just a general comment overall, because I love this comment and it just came in. It's just like, humans need holistic and MDs working together with complementary medicine docs, bridging the gap you guys rock. And it's true. So I think that's a beautiful overall comment to kind of end this fertility talk. It was a bit longer, but, you know, the questions were great. And thank you so much for both shedding some light and the good news that we could have during this time, and helping women and, you know, and their partners on the fertility journey, and just, you know, going from there. So I just want to end it there. You guys have any more comments? I think this was amazing session.
It is. And I have to say, thank you, Zuzana, for taking the lead on this. Because totally, like I said, pivoted, and this fertility talks really rocked. So thank you for doing that. And for those of you who are watching the first time, scroll down. There are lots of other talks, which includes live post number 159, Dr. Baratz was in that one as well. And we were talking about COVID, general considerations, fertility and pregnancy. So you can check that out. And the post before that was actually with Zuzana, and we're talking about her personal journey. So I'm sure you'd be interested in that as
well. Yeah, and it's really, this was today just to bring everybody together, just to give hope, right? Bridging the gap, giving hope, seeing what is possible in this time, because a lot of people do feel lonely and isolated during this time and kind of don't know what to do. So you will see all the comments at the bottom of this live. And, you know, if you have any more comments, we could see if we could get at a later time one of you to answer that, if there are specific things that we missed today. We did try to get through all questions. I think we did. I think there's more coming in, but we're going to have to stop it and go on. It's almost 10 o'clock here, so it's your time. So thank you so much. And thank you for allowing me to be part of this. Again, you guys were both my doctor, my practitioner, and just the, I can't emphasize enough how important it is to have that Western and Eastern, you know, togetherness to make it a positive fertility journey and give women hope in these times. So, and in any time. So thank you so much. And yeah, going from there. Okay. Well, thank you for joining.
Guys, thank you. Just one more thing, guys, when you're watching, please share this, because this is the whole point, right? We are isolated and we need hope. So share it. I don't know what kind of Facebook groups you're on or whatever. Just share it so that everybody gets this information. Okay.
That's right. And it's going to be posted on YouTube, right, Mary? Anybody, you have a live, I just want to mention that as well. You have a live channel on YouTube. So if anybody's missed this, you could also see this on YouTube as well.
I just want to make one final comment, which is first of all, thank you both for hosting and inviting me here. I'm sure Mary agrees. Our comments are very general comments, and you may have a specific case. This is not formal medical advice. It's just very, very good medical advice, but it is not formal.
Right.
There are specific cases and nuances, specific situations and nuances that require further discussion. We talked a lot of buzz terms tonight, like primary and secondary. I think this should be a platform for further discussion with your provider, but I guess we need a little disclaimer. These are all general comments.
Yes.
Please seek your own provider for a formal diagnosis or approach. And if I'm the provider, still talk to me, because I may have not known the whole case off my heart.
That's right. Okay. And again, it's right. It's very small comments or questions. And you're right. That's a great point. Thank you, Dr. Baratz. Mm-hmm. And again, if you guys need any inspirational books to read, check us out on bookandbrunch.com. There's about 30 to 40 books for inspiration, soothing, making you laugh, because I think we need a lot of laughter in this time. People forget about that. And go and check it out as well. And check out the social channels of Create Fertility Center and Alive Health Clinic. So thank you so much for this and for allowing me to take over Fertility Talks. Okay.
Night.
Bye.
Thank you, guys. Bye. Take care. Bye.